In John chapter 15, we hear this: greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends. What beautiful words. Words that point us to Jesus, laying down his life for us, Jesus, calling us his friends. Welcome to worship. What a great joy it is to celebrate that love that God has had for us in Jesus, and especially this Memorial Day weekend, as we think about those who have laid down their lives for their country. We honor them and celebrate them as well. Welcome to all of you, especially if you're joining us for the first time. We're so glad to have you, and we hope and pray that this is a wonderful high point in your week. I'd like to direct you to a video that we have. It's called God's Good News. It's on our website, and you can go there and learn more about Jesus and his love for you. We continue now with our opening hymn.
He is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Yesu kam, hua kam, hallelujah.
Jesus Christus bahak iten siyu, uwe bahak iten siyu, hallelujah.
Yesu Kristo amefufuka, amefufuka, hallelujah.
We gather together to worship in the name of the one true, only, and living God. We worship in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Let us confess our sins and receive the gift of forgiveness. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. Against you, O Lord, we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. Against you, O Lord, have we sinned and done what is evil in your sight. We have not loved you with all our heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. Against you, O Lord, we justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. Against you, O Lord, have we sinned and done what is evil in your sight. But for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Friends, God shows his love for us in that while we are still sinners, Christ died for us. Since, therefore, we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Rejoice then in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. We are the Barnes family. We hope everyone is doing well during these times.
Almighty God, as your only begotten Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, ascended into the heavens, so may we also ascend in heart and mind and continually dwell there with him, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Good morning, church family. This is the Horan family coming to you from our house. I'm Nathan. This is
Xander,
Carissa,
and Kay.
So today we are going to do the responsive reading taken from Psalm 110 and 47. Are you guys ready?
Yep.
Yeah.
God has gone up with a shout.
The Lord with the sound of a trumpet.
The Lord says to my Lord, sit at my right hand.
Until I make your enemies your footstool.
The Lord has sworn and will not change his mind.
You are the priest forever,
after the order of Melchizedek.
The Lord is at your right hand.
He will shatter kings on the day of his wrath.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son,
and to the Holy Spirit.
Amen. As it was in the beginning,
is now, and will be forever. Amen.
God has gone up with a shout.
The Lord with the sound of a trumpet.
All right, good job, guys. And they got Melchizedek, so we're happy about that.
Good morning. I'm Barb Scott, wishing you a great holiday weekend. And using the words from an 1882 hymn, God be with you till we meet again. Our first lesson today comes from Acts 1, verses 1 to 11. In the first book, O Theophilus, I have dealt with all that Jesus began to do and teach until the day when he was taken up after he had given commands through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. He presented himself alive to them after his suffering by many proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. And while staying with them, he ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you heard from me. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? He said to them, it is not for you to know times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all of Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. And when he had said these things, as they were looking on, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. And while they were gazing into heaven as he went, behold, two men stood by them in white robes and said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into heaven? This Jesus who is taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. This is the word of the Lord.
Hi, St. Luke's family. This is Margaret Genovese. Send you greetings from Pete, Chiara, Tessa, and I. I hope you're all staying well and that we can see each other again soon. The reading today is from Ephesians chapter 1, verse 15 through 23. For this reason, because I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints, I do not cease to give thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him, having the eyes of your hearts enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his great might, that he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the one to come. And he put all things under his feet and gave him as head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. This is the word of the Lord.
Fearful path, for my love is often cold. You must hold me fast. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so. He will hold me fast. Thank you. endless life. He will hold me fast till my faith is turned to sight when he comes at last. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. Oh, my Savior loves me so. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. Oh, my Savior loves me so. He will hold me fast.
It's always good to make the best of difficult situations and see if you can wrestle blessings out of them. Certainly this is a difficult situation for us, the church, even our nation. One of the blessings I think we're wrestling out of our time of worship together is that we've been able to highlight the various people groups that are connected to our congregation. And so with that, we continue with the gospel lesson read this morning in the Kiswahili language.
Nakwenda kusoma Injili ya Luka Mtakatifu 24, tasoma 44 hadi 53. Kisha akawaambia, hayo ndiyo maneno yangu niliyowaambia nilipokuwa nikali pamoja nanyi, ya kwamba ni lazima yatimizwe yote niliyoandikiwa katika Torati ya Musa na katika manabii na Zaburi. Ndipo akawafunulia akili zao wapate kuelewa na maandiko. Akawaambia, ndivyo ilivyoandikwa kwamba Kristo atateswa na kufufuka siku ya tatu, na kwamba mataifa yote watahubiriwa kwa jina lake habari ya toba na ondoleo la dhambi, kuanza tangu Yerusalemu. Nanyi ndinyi mashahidi wa mambo haya. Na tazama, na waletea juu yenu ahadi ya Baba yangu, lakini kaeni humo mjini hata mvikwe uwezo utokao juu. Akawaongoza mpaka Betania, akainua mikono yake akawabariki. Ikawa katika kuwabariki alijitenga nao, akachukuliwa juu mbinguni. Wakamwabudu, kisha wakarudi Yerusalemu wenye furaha kuu, nao walikuwa daima ndani ya hekalu wakimsifu Mungu.
Our service continues now with our children's message.
Butterfly,
I like that.
I have to
stop.
I found a four-leaf clover.
Does anybody see?
stood by them in white robes. These are angels. And said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into heaven? This Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way you saw him go into heaven. That will be a great day when Jesus comes back. He will raise people up from the dead, and those believers who are still alive together will all see him return, and we will go and be with him. What a great hope we have in Jesus. Yeah. All right, guys, well, let's end with a little prayer today. God, thank you for this day. Thank you for the birds and the animals, the flowers and the trees, the clouds and the sun that rises and sets. Thank you for creating everything we see. Thank you for the life we live. Thank you for Jesus who died for us so that we can go into heaven one day. What an amazing God you are. In Jesus' name, amen.
Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father, through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. A little over 50 years ago, 1969, the first ever message was sent via the internet. In those days, the internet was an early form of it. It was known as the ARPANET. It consisted of four computers, one at UCLA, one at Stanford, one at University of California, Santa Barbara, and one at the University of Utah. Well, one day, a professor at UCLA, along with a graduate student, set out to send a message to one of the computers, on Stanford's campus. The message was supposed to be the word login. Pretty simple message. So they started typing. They typed in L, and then they typed in O, and it crashed. The system crashed, and that was the message that was sent. A typo. Low. It took an hour for it to go from UCLA to Stanford. You could have almost hopped on an airplane and beat it up the coast, but nevertheless, that was a big moment. Even though it was an anticlimactic message in the history of the internet, it was a big deal, the first message ever sent. Well, since then, things have changed radically. The internet is not just four computers, but now it's billions, an untold number of laptops and desktops, smartphones, internet-connected devices, thermostats, ovens, your car. Now the internet is not just a thing on the west coast of North America, but it's around the world. It transcends continents and nations. It's everywhere. And this is how we are connecting right now. You're watching this through the internet, through this live stream. Well, long before the internet, way before the internet, God created a globally dispersed, yet fully connected community of people. Way before the internet, God had in mind for a dispersed network that was also connected. The church, the body of Christ, you and me, and the church in heaven and on earth, this is God's plan. A dispersed network that's completely connected, fully connected. We are dispersed, more so now than usual. You're there, we're here. You're in your house or wherever you're watching this from, and the sanctuary is empty. You're watching this from a different zip code, a different city, perhaps a different state, maybe even a different country. We are spread out, dispersed more than usual, but nevertheless, we're connected. We are eternally connected as brothers and sisters in Christ and connected between heaven and earth. God has made a way for us to be connected to the Father in Christ Jesus through the Holy Spirit. Dispersed yet not disconnected. We're going to be thinking about that today in the sermon. Now, in the church calendar, in the seasons of the church, we just celebrated Ascension Day. It was this past Thursday. On Ascension Day, we think about and we celebrate Jesus ascending into heaven. Jesus ascending to the right hand of God the Father, ascending to a position of power and glory and might. The ascension is 40 days after the resurrection. So 40 days from the time that Jesus is resurrected from the dead and leaves the tomb empty, and then 40 days he's ascended into heaven. Now in that time, a lot happened. Jesus appeared to over 500 people. 500 eyewitnesses, and they see Jesus. Many of them touch his hands and his feet to verify that he's not a vision, not a ghost, but really raised from the dead. These eyewitnesses, they saw him breaking bread with his resurrected hands, eating fish with his resurrected mouth. And then, after 40 days, after 500 witnesses seeing him, Jesus prepares his disciples for what's next. In the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24, we hear Jesus say this. He says, "Behold, I'm sending the promise of my Father upon you, but stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high." In the book of Acts, we hear almost the same thing. The book of Acts, chapter 1, says this. "He presented himself alive to them after his suffering by many proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. And while staying with them, he ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father." So Jesus makes it clear. As he's approaching the ascension, he tells his disciples, stay put. Don't leave. Don't disperse yet. Don't go out of the city. Stay here till the Spirit comes. Remain. But he also makes it clear that soon you're going to spread out. Soon you're going to go out. Soon you're not going to just stay here, but you're going to take this gospel everywhere. Acts chapter 1, verse 8, we hear Jesus say this. He says, "You'll receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth." Jesus tells him, before long, you're going to go out of the walls of Jerusalem. And then you're going to carry this good news of the gospel with you throughout Judea. And then you're going to take it over the border, over the cultural and the social border, into Samaria. And then from there to the ends of the earth. Jesus sent his disciples out. And that's true for us today. We are dispersed disciples. Jesus never planned for his church to be in a perpetual holy huddle. Certainly God planned for his church to gather together, as a community, to be together around word and sacrament. That was God's plan. But he also planned for the dynamic of going, of spreading, of being sent out. Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, the ends of the earth. So that wherever you are, there, right there, is a mission outpost for the kingdom of God. So the ascension of Jesus, it reminds us, especially in this time of pandemic and physical distancing, it reminds us that God planned for his church to be a dispersed network. Just like the internet, it goes out. It's global. It goes into every nation and country and continent all around the world. That's what God planned for his body, for his church. So that you and me, we connect into our social networks, into our neighborhoods, and into our communities, into our families. Like the internet, God planned for his church to transcend languages, to transcend skin colors and geography, to go out everywhere. And I know that this has been an uncomfortable time for the church, this dispersing that we've experienced, this spreading out, it wasn't our choice. This was thrust upon us by a pandemic. But we can trust and we can know that God is at work even in this. Even as the church is spread out all around this community, God's at work. Just like he sent those disciples out to the ends of the earth, we can trust that God is at work as we are spread out in our neighborhoods, in our families, as we're spread out online. But you see, the ascension, it's not only about going. It's not only about the church being dispersed, but it's also about the church being connected. We are dispersed, but we are never disconnected. God has made a way for us to be eternally and perfectly connected to him and to one another. We're dispersed, but we're not disconnected. First and foremost, God has made a way for us to connect to him. He has done this in Christ Jesus. You can think of it kind of like an internet connection. I'm sure you've had this experience before, hopefully not right now, but the experience of a broken internet connection. Whether it's between your laptop and the Wi-Fi, or the Wi-Fi and the rest of the network, somehow a connection's severed. Well, that's what sin does. Sin severs our connection to God, disconnects us from God. And that's a horrific thing. Because when we're disconnected from God, that means we're disconnected from life and peace and righteousness and hope and beauty and love, and all the good things that God gives to his people. Sin cuts that off. But Jesus, through his life, death, and resurrection, he has mended that connection for you. And that means you are back online, back connected to the Father, connected to life and hope and love and peace. You're connected back to the community of the Trinity and the community of brothers and sisters in Christ. Friends, this is good news. You've been connected to the Creator. So the ascension of Jesus is not just about Jesus going to heaven to be with God, but it's about Jesus paving a way, creating a way for you to be connected to God. Jesus talks about this. John chapter 14, he says, "I go and prepare a place for you. I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also." Jesus goes before us to prepare a way for us. That's what the ascension's about, Jesus connecting us to the Father. But not only that, but God has given to his church all these other ways that we are connected, deep connections, eternal connections. Baptism is one of these. Through the promises God makes in baptism, he connects us one to another. the triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, claiming you as his own means that you are connected to God, but you're also connected to every other baptized child of God, past, present, and future, in heaven and on earth. You're connected to every baptized child of God around the world, regardless of language and skin color, regardless of physical distancing, you are connected in baptism. Paul talks about this. Ephesians chapter 4, he says, there's one body and one spirit, just as you are called to the one hope that belongs to your call. One Lord, one faith, one baptism. One God and Father of all, who is over all, through all, and in all. He's talking about unity. He's talking about community. And he says, one Lord, one faith, one baptism. Friends, we are connected in baptism. And God has made a way for us to be connected in his word. We gather together around the word of God. We have community because of the word of God. That's what we're doing right now as we gather in this live stream around God's word. We do it on Zoom as we gather for Bible study around the word of God. Growth groups gathering around the word of God. Even when you gather around God's word as a family or with your spouse or with your children, or even if you're doing it by yourself, you are joining every other believer, every other member of the body of Christ gathered around this word of God. That is true community. That's true connection. And then finally, the Holy Spirit. Next week, we'll be celebrating Pentecost. Next week, we'll think about how the Holy Spirit is poured out and connecting us. But for now, let's remember that the Spirit is in you. And the Spirit is in me, and because the Spirit dwells in us, we are connected to God, but we have that in common. We have that as a connection. I know that this has been a time of isolation, of distance, a time where we feel really separated. I was talking to somebody yesterday, and she said, I just miss hugs. I just want a hug. And I know that people miss handshakes, or being around other people, they miss a cup of coffee with somebody else in close proximity. This has been a strange time, a time of disconnection. But the good news of Jesus is this, that even when we're dispersed, even when we are spread out, we are never disconnected. You are part of the body of Christ. I am part of the body of Christ. And this connection, it's stronger than a pandemic. It transcends physical distance. It transcends heaven and earth. It transcends all things. God has connected us to himself in Jesus, and he's connected you and me and his whole body together in Christ Jesus. Praise God for that. This is most certainly true. And now may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.
After we heard the word of God, let us proclaim our faith in the Apostle Creed. I believe in God, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and obedient, suffering under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He ascended into the hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into the heaven and sitting at the right hand of the Father Almighty. From the tent he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
I want to share a number of announcements with the congregation during this time of worship. I want to remind you that if you'd like to make an offering, you can do that through our website online. Some announcements as we're going forward. We'll continue to have our Sunday Bible classes online through the Zoom technology. There isn't one this weekend with Memorial Day, but we'll begin next week, Sunday, and the theme is Godspeed, living at the speed of God. Hope you can join us for that. This week, we're going to begin to have some gatherings for Holy Communion, and you've received notification about that. We'll meet on Thursday at either 5 o'clock or 7 o'clock at our outdoor worship center here at the Meridian campus. Saturday, we will have a communion gathering at our Christ campus at 9 a.m. and one here at Meridian campus, one at 9 and one at 11. We think we can do this safely in another place if we have some rationale on why now and how we're able to do that. But we want to use these as the beginning steps of us coming back together as the people of God. So if you're able, we would be glad to have you join us. If you're not feeling well, obviously stay home, and we'll be following all of the guidelines that we hear about through the CDC and other agencies to make sure that people are able to come and receive the sacrament in a safe way. High school students or graduates, college graduates, we'd like to recognize you on June 7. We've sent some notes out asking for some information. If you'd get that back to us soon, that would be a big help. Vacation Bible School, we're not exactly sure what we're going to be doing, but we'll have some kind of a Vacation Bible School experience in July. And then finally, Men's Retreat. If you just save the date, August 8, Saturday, August 8, we're not sure where or how or what that's going to be, but we want to be planning forward. We're not waiting for everything to pass. We want to begin to really move forward. Men, we'd like to have you involved in that. And so set that day aside, Saturday, August 8. Let's prepare for prayer. Let's join our hearts together in prayer. Almighty God, Heavenly Father, we celebrate your greatness. We celebrate how you, in your greatness, not only created the world, but redeemed the world through Jesus Christ, that you sent him into this world according to your plan, according to the prophets, and that you fulfilled what you said you would do, that you would offer him up in our place, that he might take away our sin, that he might take away our guilt, that he might take away the power of death, and that even as he has been raised from the dead, we celebrate your greatness, God, that you promised to us that we too shall live forever with you in glory. God, we pray that you'd watch over us by the power of the Holy Spirit to keep us safe as Jesus reigns at your right hand, that you would watch over us. Keep us safe until that day that we walk no longer by faith but by sight, when we see him returning in your great glory, that we might join you in your eternal presence. God, we celebrate your greatness. Lord, in your mercy. And God, we thank you that you continue to build your church through all times, through all circumstances. We thank you today for the technology that you've given to us. We heard about the internet, and we think about live streaming and Zooming, and kind of like Esther. We thank you that for a time like this, you have provided these resources, not for the business community, but for your business of building community, bringing sinners into relationship with you and with one another. And so we thank you at this time that even though we're dispersed as a people into our various neighborhoods and communities, we're also fully connected to you through your word, through baptism, through the power of your Spirit. And we pray that you would use this time of dispersion for us to be a blessing to our neighbors and friends and into our communities, that we would share the good news, the great hope of life forever in Jesus. God, thank you for building your church and watching over us in these days. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord of the nations, we pray that you'd watch over this nation and all the nations of the world. As we continue to make our way through this pandemic, we pray for peace across our land. We pray for wisdom across our land. We pray for healing across our land. We also pray for confidence across our land in you, that we might not be so anxious and so worried and so scared about all things, but that we would know that we can move forward trusting that you're with us and you're watching over us, and that we can go back out into the world. God, according to your wisdom and your timing, we pray that it would be so. We pray for our President Donald, our Governor Gretchen. We pray that you would guide them in wisdom, understanding. Help them and other leaders across our land not to devolve into bickering and fighting and partisanship, but that they would work together according to truth and wisdom and knowledge, that life might resume and that we could go more about our normal course of activities. Guide our leaders. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, we thank you for those who have been willing to lay down their lives in our military to protect this nation. Indeed, greater love has no one than to lay down his life, her life, for friends. And so we remember those who have given their lives for our nation. We pray that you would guide us to be good stewards of their gifts. We pray that you'd bless their families and friends and grant them comfort. Help us to never take for granted the great gifts that you have given to this nation. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we pray for those who are ill, those who are suffering, those who are in harm's way. Let your peace and your power be with them. Encourage them. We pray that you would grant healing to Aaron and Paul and others who may have had surgery or other procedures this week. We pray that you would comfort Dick West and his family as they mourn the death of his dear wife, Deanna. We pray for Salela and her family as they mourn the death of her father back in the Congo. Comfort those who are grieved with a sure and certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life of all those who call on your name. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, in these days, we know that there's much celebration going on, too. People are having birthdays. People are having babies. People are having anniversaries. People are getting married. We pray that you would be with all those who celebrate, that they would have great gladness of heart and hope, that the celebration that they have in part in this world is just a small foretaste of the celebration to come. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, these things and all the other petitions in our heart, we now bring before you in the name of Jesus, who taught us how to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Community and connection, you know, they've languished in these times, but there is good news. God has made a way for eternal connectivity. In Christ Jesus, we are connected to the Father, and we are connected to one another through baptism, through God's Word, through the Holy Spirit. We have community. And what a joy that is to celebrate that gift. Now go with this blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Faithfulness, O God, my Father, there is no shadow. Thank you.